and success, filled with God's treasure. This is the prerequisite for salvation. He says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, that the life of God came in your spirit, you received eternal life, you received Zoe, you received the very nature of God, you received the very ability of God. He says, he has made everything beautiful in his time. He has set eternity in their hearts. This is what God did when you got born again.
Now, patience of hope. Two very important words that are put together. Patience and hope. Patience and hope. And when we study Paul's letter to the Corinthians, we notice that there's no more hope in Christianity and in our walk of faith. Because he tells us that all the promises of God are fulfilled, for they are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Meaning to say that there is no promise that which God is expecting or looking forward to accomplish. He has accomplished everything that he needs to accomplish. And that's a reason why even the rapture is not a promise. It is a reality. It is a reality, and it is only a matter of time when the rapture takes place. And that's why you notice Paul using the word your patience of hope. What is that hope he's talking about? He's talking about the soon return of the Lord Jesus, the second coming of the Lord Jesus, which is the rapture of the church. He says, let your work of faith be combined with your labor of love and your patience of hope. Your work of faith is of no value to God if it is not combined with your patience of hope. Because all the works of faith that you can have, like the Lord Jesus says, that without love, it doesn't matter how much you can accomplish. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 says you can give your body to be burned. You can do so much, but without love, he says it is nothing. That means faith alone is not good enough. And that's why here he combines it with what is called your patience of hope. Because it's important that your faith has direction. Because God didn't give us faith to make us become earthly minded, all about getting this, getting that, getting this, getting that. I want to get that. I want to get that. I want to get that. No, that's not the reason for faith. Faith is for the accomplishment of God's purpose on the earth. That's the number one reason for faith. So if your faith is all about the things of this world, the academics, business, work, and all the things that have to do with just natural life, then that means your faith is not founded in God. And God has no respect for that faith. And that means that your faith cannot qualify. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 15, where God shows us that our works are going to be passed through fire. And if your works be burned, he says, you're going to lose your reward. So our works must be combined with what is calling patience of hope. Patience of hope, which is your expectation of the soon return of the Lord Jesus. And this is something that your excitement, your coming to church, must have that as a focus. You must have that at the back of your mind. as you use your faith to do the things that you do by faith, you must have that at the back of your mind, expecting and looking forward to the return of the Lord Jesus. The Bible tells us the prophets lived in expectation and they never received the promise. But we are they that have come and the promise has been consummated. God wants us to know how real his word is to us. And this is why when you go to James chapter 1 verse 22, let's go there. James chapter 1 verse 22. Says, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. You see, the emphasis is different. He tells us that be doers, because the word of God is no longer the voice of God from heaven as it was in the Garden of Eden, where God spoke and Adam heard the voice. The voice of God now has been infused in our human spirit. God lives in us. So he's no longer a separate entity from us, where he's guiding us from afar like a taskmaster that is telling the laborers, this is your portion. This is your portion. No, God guides you. He leads you from within you. He's inside of you. And that's why he tells us to what? Be doers. In other words, when he talks to us about patience of hope, he expects us to do it, not to believe it, because we are not believers. A believer is one that is in expectation, but a doer is one that is in its reality of what he was expecting. So he says what? Be doers. In other words, act the word. Do the word. So when he writes to us about what is to come, we should know that it is not a promise. Neither is he telling us something that might or might not happen. No. Look at 1 Corinthians, 1 Thessalonians, chapter 4. Let's start from verse 12. Okay, we can start from verse 1. It's good. Okay, just go straight to verse 13. He says, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. Now, I was showing you that on Sunday, there is Christian language. There's Christian language. And you have to make an effort to learn Christian language. You have to make an effort how to learn Christian language, how to talk like a Christian. Are you getting me? Yeah. For example, there are Christians that everything, they just respond, amen, amen. But amen is not the only response that God expects from you. Hallelujah, amen. Praise the Lord, amen. They misplace everything. Remember, when you're born again, you were born again a baby, like the Bible shows us. That means God expects you to grow. And this is why being in church, always come with an attitude of learning. Always come with an attitude of learning. Because you can go to class and learn nothing because you didn't go expecting to learn. You went because you're afraid of that lecturer, because he takes an attendance register and he uses it as part of CA. So you are in class not to learn. You are there to make the number that you are there. You can do the same with church. Always be in church for the sole purpose of learning something. Never leave church not having learned something. When you leave church, always, always make sure that you have learned something that you've added to your life, which you can come back and say, in that service, this is what God taught me. In that program, this is what I learned. In that meeting, I learned this. That is what Christianity is about. Are you hearing me? Yeah. So every church service should add something to your life. Don't make attending church a ceremonial part of your life where you attend church, but you can't trace where you're coming from. You can't trace where you're going. No. Make every moment in church a moment that leads to spiritual advancement. You are making spiritual growth. Are you getting me? Yeah. He says, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. Look at, he's using the word asleep already. Why? Because there's Christian talk, there's Christian language. There's a language which is for the church. We have our language, and our language is born out of God's word. And so, the more you learn the word of God, the more God expects you to have Christian language on your lips. Are you getting me? Yeah. For example, in the world, you have all those, your friends. Ah, but guy at Bwanji. That's the world, right? You're born again. What does God expect you to call your brother? What does God expect you to call your sister? Are you getting me? Yeah. How do you call, for example, those that you work with? You're a married man. You're a married woman. And then you have workmates that you work with. How do you relate to them? How do you call them? Or you have those that you are with in school many years back. How do you relate with them? God expects you to learn all these things. It's so important. I don't want you to lose that, even though it's a by the way thing. It says that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. Even as others which have no hope. That means we have hope. Do you get that? We have hope. That's the implication. He's telling us that we sorrow not like those that have no hope. That means that we have hope. Those of us that are in Christ Jesus, there's hope when you're a Christian. Do you understand? He says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep. You see, he's maintaining the consistency of the language. Which sleep? Which sleep? Which sleep? And not only is he wanting us to have the language, he wants us to have the meaning, the revelation. Why is he using the word sleep? Because Christians don't die. Because you died already in Christ Jesus. And now the Bible says, when a Christian passes on from this world, he has slept. That's what Paul is trying to tell us. Because when you sleep, you're going to wake up. When you sleep, you're going to wake up. And that's why he tells us we should not mourn like those that have no hope. Why? Because those that are unsaved, they're not going to wake up unto eternal life. But when a Christian sleeps on this side, he wakes up on the other side, which is heaven, where God is. And that's why he uses the word those which sleep, because truly Christians only sleep. They don't die. Because to die, it means they have to be resurrected. But to sleep, it means they're just going to wake up. They're just going to wake up. Look at verse 15. For this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. You see, he's continually using the word asleep, asleep. Then when you study 1 Corinthians, you'll notice Paul in 1 Corinthians, he doesn't use a lot of this Christian language. You know why? He mentions it at the very onset of chapter 3 when he tells them to say, when I came unto you, he says, I could not speak unto you as unto spiritual. He says, but as unto carnal, and even as unto babes in Christ. But these ones, look at how he's talking to them. And imagine, this church was much younger than the church in Corinth. You see, this is why you should know that maturity in Christianity is not based on your longevity in Christ Jesus. No.
You are listening to an audio message by Pastor Soltam Apalo from the God Life Church. To get more of our messages, visit us in Lusaka, in Liwala South, along Greg Lungu Road, off Lilai Road. We also have churches you can attend in Kabwata, Matero, along Independence Avenue, Chadley, off Greatest Road. Or visit any of our branch churches in Santhia, Mansa, Kabwe, Kitwe, Chinsali, Livingstone, Mufulira, Ndola, and Chiwombo. Follow us on YouTube and Facebook at Pastor Soto Mapalo. For more details, you can send a message or call us on 0973-74-4445. That's 0973-74-4445. Thank you and stay tuned.
Because the church in Corinth was an older church than this one. This church was less than 3 months when he was writing them this letter. Less than 3 months. And he was already communicating to them with spiritual language, which he failed to communicate with the ones in Corinth. If you look at the language in Corinth, you realize to say, hey, what were they doing? What was wrong? Because they were not full grown. They were not mature. They were carnal. He told them to say, you are yet carnal. They were born again. But they did not take the spiritual development seriously. And that's why God is saying, take your spiritual development seriously. Don't just attend church. No. Attend church like the Berean Christians, who, when they came to church, they wrote down every scripture the man of God was using, so that when they get home, they'll search the scriptures for themselves. And God took notice of them. And that's why you find these ones, as young a church as they are, Paul is using spiritual language to them, referring to them how they had all the elements of a mature church. Oh God, may God say that of us. Yeah. Because, I mean, he didn't tell the church in Corinth to say, your works of faith, your labor of love, No, they're the ones that he was telling. He said, it doesn't matter how much faith you have. Even if you burn your body and you do all these things without love, that means they were a church that they didn't walk in love. They were in church for themselves. You remember, they are the same ones in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul is telling them about the communion and is admonishing them, telling them to say, look, stop this nonsense of when you come together, you have others that eat more of the communion than others. That was in Corinth, not in Thessalonica. It gives you an idea what type of a church the Corinthian church was. A very, very carnal church. But remember, a carnal church is made up of carnal Christians, right? Yeah. He says, for this we say unto you, by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Now look at 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Are you getting that? He says, the Lord Jesus, he's going to come with a shout. But now, have you ever asked yourself, if he's going to come with a shout? I mean, if it's a shout, ordinarily, everybody should hear him. But we know that the rapture is going to be a surprise, because the people in the world, like the Bible says, that the day of the Lord is going to be like the day of Noah, where they were eating and drinking. And many of them are just going to be amazed that suddenly we have vanished. We're not here. But in the meantime, we are told he will come with a shout. He will come with a shout. This is why you have to learn to understand that when God shouts, when God speaks, he speaks to your human spirit. He doesn't speak to your carnal ears. So that shout, all of us that are born again and have the patience of hope, will hear it. And that's the one we will respond to, that shout. But you know what? All the unsaved, all the Christians that do not have the patience of hope, they will not hear that shout. Because they are the ones that will be saying, they're gone. They're not here. I know what the Bible says, that this was going to happen. Because it's going to catch them by surprise, just like the sinners. But everyone who is living in expectation of his soon return, we will hear that shout. Whether you were sleeping, you will hear it in your sleep. And this is why nobody should be worried to say, what if rapture? There are people that have asked me to say, Pastor, what if rapture happens at 02? Deliberately at times I ask people to say, what time would you like rapture to happen? And most of the time, Pastor, Sunday. You know, there are a lot of people who are ready on Sunday. But you see, you should be ready all the time. No, you should be ready all the time. Whether it's going to come at 02, whether it's going to come, because remember, 02 here in Japan, it's probably 14 hours. So whichever way, he's told you already. He's going to come with a blast, and we will hear it. And immediately, this is what is going to happen. He says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. You see, what is letting us know is that those that died in Christ Jesus, they're going to get out of their tombs. They're going to get out of their graves. They're going to rise first. And then look at that. Verse 17. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. With them. With them. Who are the them? The dead in Christ. And this is one of the things. You see, oh, this is lovely. Look. The Bible says, he's going to shout. As he enters space, you know space, right? Yeah. Yeah. You bypass space station. And then as he enters the Earth's atmosphere, maybe even way above that, I'm trying to relate with your science. He's going to shout. We will hear the shout. But the Bible says, those that are dead, the Christians that have gone ahead of us, he says they will rise first. In the meantime, we are the ones that are ahead. He says they will rise first and be swapped out of their graves. And then we will join them. In other words, oh God. And this is why, don't plan to get ready on that day. You will not manage. Just look at, we who are here. This is the guy who's 6 feet down. He's going to bypass us. And he's going to be with God first, Jesus first. Then we'll join him. Are you getting that? There's no time to prepare on that rapture day. The time to prepare is now. Get ready now. Because even just the dramatic scene of it shows you there's no room for preparation. Because while he's shouting, the dead in Christ everywhere, no matter where they died. You may say, Pastor, what about those whose bodies were eaten by sharks? Like, for example, we had our national team that died in 93. Some of you saw their bodies, how their bodies were not complete. You can imagine, in that minisecond, their bodies will come together and be swamped up. And then they'll join the Lord in the air. Are you getting that? Because I was once asked to say, Pastor, so what will happen with those that were cremated? You know what cremation is, right? Those ones that when a person dies, they burn the body. And then they just remain with the ashes. From that point where he was cremated, His body is going to come together. And then, with that glory of God passing over his body, then his glorified body will be lifted up. And this is why that answers another question. To say, Pastor, what about that brother that was in the process of time, became blind? Is he going to be raised from the dead with a blind eye? Or the one who lost his leg to diabetes, is he going to join the Lord in the air with one leg? No, he's not. Don't forget that. I'll show you. We'll go step by step. But he's not going to go to the Lord. Because remember, okay, just la over negis. Look at verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not. That you sorrow not. There's no sorrow with God. A blind eye, a lame brother or sister, would not make you so happy. So that tells you already. But we'll get into more detail. Look at verse 17. He says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So he's not going to touch down. He's going to be in the air, like the Bible says. And we are the ones that are going to join them. We're going to join them. Then from there, look at what it says. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. That means from there, then he takes us together with us to heaven. And then we're going to be in heaven for some time. And then we're going to come back with him for the battle of the Armageddon, like the Bible shows us. Read Revelation chapter 12, 13, 14, 15. And you notice that we're going to come back. So we're not going to go to heaven forever. No, we're not going to stay in heaven forever. Because the Lord still has business to do. Remember, those of us that are going to be taken off, we're going to leave some that we witnessed to, but they were hardened. And the Lord Jesus still has interest and still has those that are going to give their lives in the tribulation. The ones that the Bible calls the tribulation saints. Those that are going to die. And those that, of course, are going to be alive by the time of the second return of the Lord Jesus. When we come together with him now. When he comes to judge the world. But that's not where we're going for today. We are on patience of hope. Let's go to 1 Corinthians. Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Go to from verse 50. He says, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither do corruption inherit incorruption. Now, I'm trying to answer that question to say, what about somebody who lost his kidney? Is he going to rise with one kidney? Look at what God says. He says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither doeth corruption inherit incorruption. Verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Are you getting that? We shall all be changed. So, that brother that lost a kidney, his kidneys shall be changed. Hallelujah. Yeah. That tattoo is going to be gone. No, you're not going to have tattoos in heaven. Suddenly that tattoo will be gone. We will not be reading tattoos on your palm and on your back. And no, there will be no tattoos in heaven. Because your whole body will be cleansed, washed clean.
You have just heard a message produced by the God Life Church Media. For more messages by Pastor Sotha Mapalo, visit thegodlifechurch.org or contact us on 0973-744-445. 0973-744-445. Remember to tune in every Tuesday at 17:30 hours on One Love Radio. God bless you.